Would you all stand with me while we sing some praise and worship songs? And because we don't have drums, it would be really nice if you guys could clap really loud. Okay. Turn your ear to heaven and hear the noise inside, the sound of angel songs and the sound of angel songs and all this for a king. We could join and sing to Christ the King. How constant, how divine, this song of ours will rise. Oh, how constant, how divine, this love of ours will rise. Will rise. Gaze to heaven and raise a joyous noise. The sound of salvation come in the sound of rescued ones, and all this for a king. Angels join to sing, all for King. How infinite and sweet, this love so rescuing. Oh, how infinitely sweet, this great love that has redeemed. As one we sing, Alleluia.
How's everybody doing tonight? Great. The other day, I just learned that Andrew could sing, so I was super excited that he was singing tonight with Kaylee. You're doing great. No, I won't be singing tonight. I'll leave it to the worshipers. I did want to thank everybody who supported the Bridge to Bridge ride. We did meet our goal. We even made more, so thank you guys so much. And we also have a guest speaker tonight, Ernst Van Eeghen. The Bridge absolutely loves him, so we're glad he's going to be up here sharing the word with you guys. So I'll go ahead and get into the statement. Regeneration. Regeneration is a group of men and women affected directly or indirectly by any life-dominating sin. Regeneration. To throw off your old sinful nature and your former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes, put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. We no longer have to walk in the guilt and shame of our past, and we can now overcome the hopelessness resulting from our addictive behavior by remembering the promise from 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. We believe that a person can be set free from addiction and compulsive behavior by the power that comes from Christ. We are told in 1 Peter 5:8, be alert and of sober mind because the enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. We believe that attending meetings such as this and applying biblical principles to our lives, that we can be set free from the chains of addiction and begin to live productive, joy-filled lives. Jesus said, the thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. And I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. Again, I just want to welcome everybody who's here tonight. I want to welcome everybody who's on our live stream. If you would like to connect in any way, if you have any questions, you can email regenerationmeeting@gmail.com. Or you can ask me, you can ask Mike, you can ask Michelle or Susie. Anyone in the leadership team, if you have any questions or would like to connect in any way, if you need prayer. And if you would like to give, you can do so by dropping your tithes in the offering box, which is one up here and one right over here. You can also give online if you go to calvary.com and select Regeneration, or you can make your check out to Calvary and then memo Regeneration. So I totally skipped the chips. Is anybody new here tonight? We're gonna do chips right now, and we give out a welcome chip. So is there anybody here that's new tonight for the first time? We got one over here. What was your name? Micah, welcome. We're glad you're here tonight. Is there anybody else here for the first time? Sal, welcome. We're very glad you're here. Anybody else? Okay. Is anybody celebrating 30 days of sobriety? Is anybody celebrating 60 days of sobriety? 90 days? 6 months? 9 months? Is anybody celebrating 1 year of sobriety? Multiple years? Okay. All right. Well, I'll go ahead and pray, and then we'll get into some more worship. Lord God, I thank you for who you are, Lord, and all that you're doing, Lord, and all that you will do. I just want to thank you for everybody that's here tonight, Lord. I want to lift up Ernst, and I just ask that you speak through him, Lord, and that you speak to each person who's watching tonight, each person who's here tonight, Lord. I just pray that you touch each one of them in a different way, Lord God, and that we just want to give you this evening tonight in worship, and we just want to honor your name. We want to give you glory, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our King, come let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Dancing your freedom awake and alive. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again, for your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things, God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You freed every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great. Above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things.
One more time.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You freed every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh, God, you do great. Imagine what it'd be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all? Dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. When all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation of kings, you are my everything, and I
Ooh, cannot see anything here. My goodness. All right. Good evening, everybody. It's a cold night compared to last week. I'm glad I'm wearing a jacket. Hope you guys are somewhat comfortable. My name is Ernst, and I'm not a pastor. So what I'm going to talk about tonight is a part of scripture that I was studying several weeks ago. And I want to share with you what the Lord gave me in studying this. And over the last week or so, I was wrestling with the text. And I'm looking forward to share that with you. First of all, I want to share a little bit on who I am. This is not a Californian accent that you hear. This is not lost on me. So anyone that wants to heckle me, please don't. I found my faith right here in this church about 7 years ago. And I moved here from Amsterdam in the Netherlands, certainly not one of the most godly places in the world. And I work in the produce industry. So if I lose my train of thought tonight, you guys are going to learn everything you need to know about farming. About a little over 10 years ago, 11 years ago, I met my wife, Gretchen, whose birthday it was yesterday, by the way. When we got married, there was nothing more than for us our desire to have children. And we were really hoping that this was going to happen. And when you're a little older, like me, apparently it's not that easy for everybody. So we tried to get Gretchen pregnant, and I went on a diet and started eating healthy and all that stuff, and it didn't work, and it didn't work. And so we started exhausting some of the medical technologies that are out there. And after 5 long years and a pretty deep challenge on our marriage too, when prayers are unanswered, Gretchen became pregnant with a child. And she is also, other than just my partner in crime, she is my heart and soul. And she's the one that led me to church initially. Gretchen is from the south, from Oklahoma, and she grew up in a church home. And she decided, or she asked me if I wanted to join her on Sundays to church. I didn't object, but that was pretty much everything I did. I never really received it. I enjoyed it, but sermons to me were a piece of mint. It felt really good at the time, but within 5 minutes of being outside the church, somebody ticked me off, and I was right back where I started again. But I enjoyed the stories and all that stuff, and we got married in church. We were just in a good place, I think. And Sam, our son, was born, and life couldn't be any better. I had a good job. Our life at home seemed to be falling apart, and it was worth the 5-year wait. A little over 5 months later, the Lord decided to take him back. And we lost him. I turned my back to the Lord. The first thing I did, a loving God cannot do anything like this. And I fell in this deep hole, because once you turn your back to the Lord, there's this other guy waiting for you. And he was waiting for me with open arms, and I was starting to make things worse than they already were. And I fell in a deep, deep hole. And there came a point when I was at my absolute worst. I could have destroyed my marriage, in addition to losing a son, where I got called to go back to church. And we decided to go to a different church, and we got married in, and we decided to go right here. And that Sunday morning, I found my faith. Something changed in me, radically changed in me from that day onward. And life has not been the same ever since. Everything has been better. And I think that's the big message, of course, in our faith, is that we serve a God that wants to heal us. And in the piece of scripture we're going to talk about, there's a healing going on as well. So we're going to be in Luke 11, and the section I was studying that I want to share with you, I'm going to break it down in a couple of sections. What we'll see is that Jesus is going to do kind of like an exorcism. He's going to heal a man from being possessed by a demon. And there's people in the crowd that witness this, and they question this, which is, to me, already incredible. And then we see also Jesus setting misconceptions straight about who Satan is and what he can do and what he can do. And then we finish up with a part where Jesus is getting some praise out of the crowd as well, from a very special person, I think. And why did this resonate with me? First of all, because I feel like I've done a 180 in my life, a complete transformation in my life, and where I am today and where I used to be. And that is still an ongoing story. So what we're going to read about in this section is that a divided kingdom won't stand, a divided house won't sustain. And I've learned that firsthand. So will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for this gathering here tonight. We thank you, Father, for your word. And we thank you, Father, that you know us, that you want to heal us, that all we have to do is confess to you, Lord, that you are Lord, and for you to take the reins in our lives, Father, and turn us away from the things that don't glorify you, that don't point at you, Father. So I pray that you'll speak through me tonight, Father, and that you're going to bless us with your presence here tonight. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. So the light is not very good up here, and I'm 48, so my eyes aren't that good anymore, so I'll be leaning forward here a little bit to go through the text. These are really small letters. I should have done that differently. So we're going to be in Luke 11, and I'm going to start at verse 14. Since I cannot read anything right now, I doubt that you guys in the doubt can read anything either. So bear with me. In verse 14, we start off, Jesus was driving out a demon that was mute. And when the demon left, the man who had been mute spoke, and the crowd was amazed. But some of them said, by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, he is driving out demons. And others tested him by asking him for a sign from heaven. To me, a couple of things that we see up here in this miracle that's taking place is, we're not being told a lot about really what happened and how the miracle, the healing took place. We just know that it took place. What we also read here is that the man was mute. The demon was mute, which again points at the imperfection of anything that the enemy does, that Satan does. It just cannot produce anything perfect. And what I love about this is just it simply says when the demon left. So there's no long battle story about what's going on, and definitely not recorded up here. But there's an instant victory. And the man spoke. There's an instant healing that's going on. Incredible. But what's, I think, even more incredible is the reaction of the crowd. The crowd was in awe. I would be in awe. When I would face witnessing a miracle like that, there's a couple of things you can do. You can be totally in amazement and wondering what's going on, what happened here. This is unbelievable. Or you can immediately point at God and say, this is something that only God can do. But you can feel the happiness, the joy for the actual healing taking place. But then we also read that there were some in the crowd that refused to contribute this to God. The one thing that they saw is something negative. And they started contributing this healing to Beelzebul, which is kind of like a common term back then of Satan. Can you imagine witnessing something like this and instead of seeing the beauty of it, that you immediately start doubting that and that it must be something bad? And then it says, others tested him by asking for a sign from heaven. Thank you. There you go. Thank you. So, from a sign from heaven. So, they're trying to explain the unexplainable by more unexplainable. Right? To me, it just doesn't even make sense what's going on up here. And this division in the crowd, and I think it points at our limited understanding as well of sometimes God's works and what all he can do. But the one thing we do read here that some of the people there didn't attribute this miracle to God. So as we're moving on in verse 17, it reads, Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, and this is the key verse, any kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and a house divided against itself will fall. If Satan is divided against himself, how can this kingdom stand? I say this because you claim that I drive out demons by Beelzebul. Now, if I drive out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your followers drive them out? So then they will be your judges. But if I drive out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. What I love about this section is that it said Jesus knew. Jesus knew their thoughts. Just as much as he knows my thoughts, your thoughts, which is a beautiful truth bomb here. It's also a very scary one, right? Anyone? Okay, good. I'm not alone. But it's a beautiful thing. And he starts explaining what's going on up here. So he knows that people are questioning by the power of what this is happening. And the explanation is very simple. It's like he pretty much questions them and says, how could it be the enemy? How could this be Satan? Satan comes to kill and destroy and then heal, right? That doesn't make sense. It just doesn't. And what Jesus is saying here is that the root of the problem here is not physical. It's really a spiritual problem. Satan cannot drive himself out. So there's only one other way that it's happening. And he points at this and he says, but if I drive out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Jesus makes sure for everybody to understand that the healing comes from God and from nobody else. And what I like too is that it's as simple as the finger of God. And indirectly here, and maybe not so indirectly, he's also saying he's revealing who he really is, because who did this miracle? It was Jesus himself. That's how easy it was. And that's how he sets them straight. But he knows that there needs to be more to be explained. So he continues in verse 21. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his house, his possessions are safe. But when someone stronger attacks and overpowers him, he takes away the armor in which the man trusted and divides up his plunder. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his house. This is speaking of Satan. He's strong. He's powerful. He's well armed. And when we're looking at some of the armor that the enemy uses, I think we've all experienced many of them. Temptation, lust, comparison, doubt, self-doubt, regret, shame, anyone? These are tools, these are the weapons of Satan to keep you under his control. And I think it's important to realize that we all face these feelings from time to time, that you know where they're coming from. They're not the feelings we're supposed to have. These are not coming from God. And Jesus clearly states here that our enemy is strong, is very strong, and it's extremely difficult to get away from his grip. I beg to say even that it's pretty much impossible to do so on your own strength. But when a stronger man comes in, and who is the stronger man? Jesus. 9 out of 10 questions in church that you get, the answer is Jesus. Just in if there's the next one. If you don't know what to say, say Jesus. Usually that's all right. The stronger man is?
Jesus.
He comes in and attacks and overpowers him and takes away the armor in which the man trusted and divides up his plunder. And his plunder is everything that the enemy took from us, is under his control. And we're going to talk about that later, because sometimes we like to leave things behind. We're not all in. So we're going to talk about a little bit later about the application of that. And I think the biggest thing that he says here is, whomever is not with me is against me, and whoever doesn't gather with me scatters. Who's not with me is against me. It's a pretty hard statement. But what Jesus is trying to tell here is that it's one or the other. It's not a little bit of Jesus. It's all or nothing. So, and you've got to get this right. When there's a battle with Satan between good and evil, this is a battle much bigger than ourselves. So it's all or nothing. Which side are you choosing? And this warning, we're going to talk about that in a little bit. It's really something I want tonight to communicate with you guys, because that's really what God has been sharing with me as I was going through this scripture. Because when we're talking about a divided kingdom, a divided house, we're talking about a divided heart. My heart, my house, your house. And the message here that there's no neutrality. You cannot be neutral in this battle because it's bigger than us. You got to pick a side. All or nothing. Verse 27. As Jesus was saying these things, a woman in the crowd called out, "Blessed is the mother who gave birth and nursed you." He replied, "Blessed are rather those who hear the word of God and obey it." What I love about this section, it's easy to overread, but to read this and not catch on to it, but there's somebody in this crowd that receives this message and has no other way than to shout it out. And who's this woman? This was a woman in that time. Women didn't have the same rights as they have today. They were really not expected to speak up. Certainly not in the presence of all these men and probably some church leaders at the time that were questioning Jesus in this particular case. This was a very brave woman that spoke up. She just didn't have a choice. She received this message, and she says, "Blessed is the mother who gave birth and nursed you." She gives glory to Jesus' mother. And Jesus responds, blessed are rather those who hear the word of God and obey it. And don't get this wrong. Jesus is not saying anything negative to this woman at all. By no means. He's not setting her straight. He's actually adding to her statement. And he adds, blessed are those who hear the word of God. Those, it's, he makes it a very inclusive statement. Not just blessed are you, you and you there in the back. No, he makes it, blessed are those who hear the word of God. Because the woman wasn't wrong. Jesus, of course, loved his mother. And as it's even in the Ten Commandments, honor your father and your mother. And this is a beautiful way where I think Jesus is sharing the inclusiveness of our faith, if that's a word. If not, I just made it up. And again, here he's revealing who he really is. So when we go through this text, and when I read this text, I'm reading this, and I love all these biblical stories, and I love all the miracles of Jesus. And but there's a part of me as well that has a little bit like, all right, so what? You know, what does it really mean to us today? What is the Lord telling us when we're reading this? And so I started thinking about this, what this really means. And one of the things that I think we can ask ourselves is, are we aware of the power of Satan? How much control he really can have over us if we're not all in? And I think in a great way, it's this piece of scripture holds up a mirror to ourselves and asks ourselves, how clean is our house? So there's three applications I wanted to share with you tonight. I want to talk about ways to protect your home. I want to talk about what we should let in and what we should get rid of. And it doesn't matter if you're half in the faith, you just touched it a little bit, you kind of know who Jesus is, but don't know, or you've been a Christian for 50 years. I can tell you that someone like Pastor Buck here, Jeff Buck here at church, he's been a Christian for decades. Do you think he locks his door at night? He locks his door at night. So this message, really the application is for us as people that have maybe lost a house. And with the house, I also talk your heart. Maybe you're rebuilding something, or maybe you live in a house right now that feels pretty good. So I think the practical implications, let's talk about ways to protect our home. In what areas do you think you need to clean up a little bit in your house? And I think that differs for all of us individually, what it really means. I think we know that prayer, scripture, sermon, fellowship, those are all good things, right? Relationships. Another way to really protect your home is in this relationship sphere is make friends, make good friends. Make good friends with Jesus. You know, see him as a good friend, because good friends are there with each are there for each other. Improve your relationship with him. As he said, the closer you get to him, he's going to hold on to you as well. Because as we read in John 5, abide in me and I will also abide in you. It's something we actively pursue. Surround yourself with good people, which is also not always easy. I think in my relationships that I found is that sometimes I meet people for a reason, a season, or a lifetime. You probably have heard of that. I think there's a lot of truth in that. And these friendships are very important for me that I have. I've got certain friends that will really keep me honest and will question how I'm really doing. think another way to protect your home is to serve him, to serve other people, and be an extension of his hands here on the earth. And I think to practice patience is a great way to protect your home as well. Make no enemies. You've got to pick your battles here a little bit. And make no enemies, and trying to forgive someone, an enemy that you may have, is one of the hardest things you can do. And I struggle with that every day, and I'm pretty sure many of you do too. It's probably the hardest thing to do. And if you're struggling with this, I can maybe share with you that there's a book about a lady called Corrie ten Boom. It's a great story about forgiveness. She is a survivor from the Holocaust, and she runs into a Nazi who was a camp guard at a concentration camp. And she's able to forgive him, which is still, to me, absolutely mind-boggling. But it's a beautiful story that forgiveness is possible. I'm not telling you to do it, because I know how difficult it is for me to do it, but just to understand that it's possible is really encouraging to me. Pick your battles. You know, it's sometimes difficult to do to not pick your battles. In traffic here on my way in, I almost got into a battle. Anyone? No? Nobody, huh? Thanks. Appreciate that. Oh, we got one here. All right. Thank you. But really, a way to protect your house is don't conform. Don't conform. Like, if somebody's being a ding-dong to you, I just said ding-dong in church. Are we in church, Mike? Yeah? Sorry about that. I said ding-dong in church. If somebody's being a ding-dong to you, and you're being a ding-dong back to him or her, guess what? Two ding-dongs. Don't conform. Easier said than done. I think I can do it on my way home tonight. There's barely any traffic, but man, traffic can be a tough one for me. But it's true, though. The high road is very difficult to walk, but that's where we separate ourselves from others as well. I think dwelling on the past for me is one I've struggled with. I come from this city where a lot is possible. Amsterdam offers a lot of things the world has to offer to us, but doesn't have a lot to offer what the Spirit has to give us. At least I didn't catch on to that. I've got guilt. I've got shame. I've done some things in the past that I'm really not proud of, but I can't allow it to continue to sit on my shoulders. And in our faith, we have this. In Jesus, we've got somebody that can help us with this. Why do people like Southwest Airlines so much? Anyone? The bags fly free. Right? So, but really, that goes in our life as well. If you go on a long trip and you got a big suitcase with you, try to imagine going through the airplane. You're bumping people. There's no room. You're going slow. You're not getting anywhere. You're losing stuff along the way. That's actually what's happening with the baggage that you carry in your life as well. You're irritating other people with it a little bit. You're bumping left and right. But the beautiful thing is with our Savior, with Jesus Christ, we have someone that will take it over from us. You can check that in. And this may be an ongoing thing. It's not an overnight thing like that, but I can tell you, I don't carry that burden as much. His yoke is light. And how do you do that? You got to confess. You got to speak to him. Like, on a daily basis, I confess to God. I've got all these great plans in the morning of how I'm going to dedicate my day to him. And on my way back from the office, I ask for forgiveness for all the things I did. Anyone? Okay, I'm here alone too, right? So, but this is an ongoing thing, and again, this transformation takes time, and it's a beautiful thing that we can take it off, that we can check in our luggage with Christ. And I think one of the things that we can look at as well is the way we react to others, and for me, that is taming my tongue. even in the traffic earlier, you know, it's so quick to lash out. If something happens, somebody doesn't agree with what you're doing, I do that very easily. That's something I struggle with as well. But I gotta tame my tongue. It's something you can practice to keep your mouth shut. When you shake a can of Coke and you open it up, what's going to happen? Psst. When I get shaken up and I open myself up, what's going to happen? Psst. Right? It's the same thing. And again, these are kind of like, and I joke about it, but this is real stuff, y'all. This is stuff we, most of us, suffer from. And the thing is, it doesn't belong in our house. It just doesn't. I think one of the great ways to protect your home as well is in relationship with others, just listen to others. I think there's a reason we got two ears and one mouth. You can love people by listening to them and not always speak. And there's so many different other ways where you can protect your home. Now, the second application is, what are you letting in? Because what comes out of you, you allow it in one way or the other. When I get squeezed in the corner and I lash out, like I said, there's something I allowed in because I had to put it in myself first. So let's talk about that. I think we got to make room in our lives for a couple of really positive emotions as well. And maybe that sounds a little hippie-ish, but I think it's true. There's some truth in there to live by gratitude. Be thankful for the big things. Be thankful for the little things. You know, I had a friend that kind of, he can live by thanking God for this breath that he's taking. That may be a bridge too far for you, right? But the little things in life, our health, our good relationships, the home that we have, or the process we're in, the patience God has with me. I've given God 1,000 reasons not to love me, but he still does. Gratitude. It's a great and powerful thing. I think serenity is something else that we can control. Find serenity. Sometimes it's good to step away, to be alone with God. We're not meant to be alone, but we're meant to be alone with God. When we're alone without God, usually not so good. But having that alone time is a great, great way to settle your soul a little bit and wait for the Lord to speak into you. Joy over things that you can celebrate too. You know, it's. I think hope is a great emotion too that we can hold on to, and the hope in our transformation. You know, we like to sometimes focus on all the bad things we're doing. But if you know that something is not right, you did something not right, you sometimes have that feeling of conviction. My conviction is very often stronger than Gretchen setting me straight or something, or even... But when the Lord speaks to me in my conviction, that can be very, very powerful. And enjoy the outside, enjoy creation. That's a really good form of inspiration as well on who our Creator really is. And all these things can create kind of like an undue effect when you're, you know, in a down place, when you're not feeling good, when you're negative, when you're feeling a little bit in a hole. And what are you letting in also refers to your relationships. It really does. I'm never going to say that you should block people out of your life. Maybe you should, but that's not up to me, because there's also a commandment that we should love our neighbor. But there's a time and a place for everything. And the way I try to live that out is everybody's welcome, but not everybody's invited. Does that make sense? And I think to make that distance with certain people that are not edifying, a beautiful Christian word of saying it's not good for you, good for the kingdom, I think it's important. I think these relationships have a big impact on our day-to-day lives, for me at least. And as we're moving now to the last application, and as the third one will need to come out, and the way I was thinking of this, and a couple of days ago I heard... somebody talk about a great analogy that I loved is if you imagine a big glass of water, tall glass of water that's half filled with water, half filled with oil. You just want a clean glass of water. So how are you going to get that oil out? It separates, right? So the oil sits on top of the water. You can try to scoop that out one by one. It's going to take you a long time. You may not get everything out. You know what the best way is to get that oil out? More water. Put in more good things. I think our focus so often on the bad things in our lives. But if you put in more good things, the bad things will go. I can tell you. It's going to happen. So what needs to come out? You guys know for your own life. I don't know what needs to come out in your life. I think a good way is just being really honest to yourself. It's looking at your house. What's, you know, are there any cracks in the ceiling, in the roof? Are there any locks that are not working? Are there cockroaches that don't belong there? In college, I lived with 13 other guys. Oh, brutal. That place was nasty. But now I live in a house that is a lot cleaner. I'm a lot more comfortable. But you got to look at your own situation. What needs to come out? And I know still in my life what needs to come out. There's stuff that still needs to come out. I'm not going to clean it all the way up. Certain habits, certain thoughts, they're difficult to get out of your life. Social media. Anyone? A lot of connections, right? Loose connections aren't real relationships. What people think on social media, it doesn't matter at all. So don't hold any value to it. What else needs to come out? Being on your smartphone for hours at night. That's the kind of stuff for me that needs to come out. So I may not be checking work emails at night anymore, but I'm playing solitaire. I'm looking at myself as, man, you're just so lame. What needs to come out? But it all starts with you, with you individually. What needs to come out? If you look in the mirror, you know what needs to come out. And it starts right there. And you can only control you. I heard a saying once from a friend of mine who's a Marine, and he told me, I love this saying, he said, you train like you fight because you fight like you train. And I love that message, and I think it applies to many of us here tonight. I'm in a state of comfort, somewhat comfort. I don't have any big battles going on or anything like that, but this is the exact time where I should be in training more than ever. Maybe you are in a program right now where you have some kind of protection. This is the time where you got to lean in more than ever, because I'm telling you guys, the battle is coming again. You're going to face it again. I'll tell you why that is. And I told you about what happened when my son passed away. That was a horrible time. 2 years after Sam passed away, I was doing some Devo time at a Starbucks, and at 6 in the morning, and my phone goes off, and it's my dad. He was calling from Holland, 9-hour time difference. And I looked at it as like the old man must have forgotten the time difference or whatever, so I let it go to voicemail. I get a text immediately after, you got to call me. So I called him because I knew something was up, and he told me that my twin brother, Chris, just took his life hours before that. And again, I sat here and the world turned black around me, completely. And after a couple of minutes, I snapped out of it. It felt like a couple of hours. And I looked around and I'm like, what am I supposed to do? What am I supposed to do now? Am I supposed to, at 6 in the morning, wake up Gretchen and the girls, because I got beautiful twin girls? Or do I go to the office and tell them I got to go back home? Or what am I supposed to do right now when you get this news? The second time, and I felt all these scars, I felt them rip open again, bleeding. And I looked down on the table where I was sitting, and there was scripture. The Bible was sitting right in front of me, still closed, because I just got my coffee. And I was like, well, I just opened it up in a random spot and see what God had to tell me. And it landed on Ecclesiastes 2 and 3, which Ecclesiastes 2 describes that toil is meaningless and chapter 3 writes about that there's a time for everything. There's a time for there's a time for war. There's a time to love. There's a time to dance. There's a time to dance. And then in verse 11 it read, and he has made everything beautiful in its time. My twin brother Chris was a very outgoing person. He was a bigger than life personality. He had everything the world had to offer in Amsterdam. Lots of money, very good looks, many, many beautiful girlfriends. He was the bachelor of Amsterdam, pretty much. And he was in gossip magazines. He lived the lifestyle. But at the end of the day, he had nothing. But he has made everything beautiful in its time. And that was the Lord putting his hand on my shoulder at that very moment, giving me the comfort, it's okay. He is with me. And why I'm sharing this story, because stuff is going to happen. When Sam passed away, I fell on my face. When Chris passed away, I fell on my knees. There's a big difference. By staying connected to Christ, he will empower you. He will strengthen you even when these attacks come. And this transformation, like I said, is not an overnight thing. And I got a lot of scars. My scars are not a reminder of my pain. They're proof of my healing. And that's the way I'd like you guys to look at yourself and then at your own lives as well. We serve a God that is so much greater. But you gotta be all in. Which means you gotta stop lying to yourself. Your past doesn't define your story. It doesn't. It's just a chapter. So let me ask you, how is your story going to end? How are you going to finish your story? Do you have a divided house? Do you have a divided heart? It's your choice. Remember, we're on the winning team, guys and girls. We're on the winning team. This battle has already been won. It's up to you to grab it and to hold on to it. Nothing in your life should stay under the dominion of Satan. You gotta give it all up to Jesus. And then you can share in the joys and his blessings as well. You're on the winning team already. Anyone need Jesus tonight? Anyone needs a clean house? I do. He can make that happen. So let's choose Jesus tonight in our lives. Let's make that choice tonight. Let's pray. The Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for who you are. Thank you, Lord, that you are a redeeming God that loves us and that will give us chance after chance and after chance to come to you. You don't count the sins that we've committed against you. You just want us to come home. Father, we pray that your word will not just enter our hearts, Lord, but take full custody of it. Fill up our homes, fill up our house, fill up our hearts. Take control over every room in our house, Lord. Fill it up, we ask tonight. Give us the power tonight to review ourselves and review our lives. And take action, Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Father, for who you are. and we commit ourselves to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Shake the mountains, break the walls apart, open the heavens, Almighty God, you are overcomer, defender of my heart. By your power, the oceans open wide, your fire falls down, heaven and earth collide. King Jesus, forever by my side. Shake the mountains, break the walls apart, open the heavens, Almighty God, you are overcomer, defender of my heart.
A little chilly out tonight.